Welcome to this special edition of Living Truth, shot on location in Greece and Turkey. The Apostle Paul traveled through these lands 2,000 years ago as he shared the truth of the gospel of Christ to both Jew and Gentile. The times were turbulent under Roman rule, and the world was witnessing the birth of the church, whose history we share in today. Charles Price will bring us God's Word and the context for this dramatic part of the church's history. In looking back and understanding Paul's mission and vision, we too will be inspired to follow Christ in a deeper, more intimate way. Stay with Living Truth for a message from Charles Price.
Did you ever know God better than you know Him today?
This message was recorded in Athens, Greece, during a retreat with Living Truth viewers on the shore of the Aegean Sea.
Now I'm going to ask you to turn in your Bible this afternoon to Jeremiah and chapter 2. Jeremiah and chapter 2. I'm going to read from verse 1 down to verse 14. And he is addressing the people of God, people of Israel. The word of the Lord came to me, "Go and proclaim in the hearing of Jerusalem, I remember the devotion of your youth. How as a bride you loved me and followed me through the desert, through a land not sown. Israel was holy to the Lord, the first fruits of his harvest. All who devoured her were held guilty, and disaster overtook them, declares the Lord. Hear the word of the Lord, O house of Jacob, all you clans of the house of Israel. This is what the Lord says. What fault did your fathers find in me that they strayed so far from me? They followed worthless idols and became worthless themselves. They did not ask, where is the Lord who brought us up out of Egypt and led us through the barren wilderness, through a land of deserts and rifts, a land of drought and darkness, a land where no one travels and no one lives? I brought you into a fertile land to eat its fruit and rich produce. But you came and defiled my land and made my inheritance detestable. The priests did not ask, where is the Lord? Those who deal with the Lord did not know me. The leaders rebelled against me. The prophets prophesied by Baal, following worthless idols. Therefore, I bring charges against you again, declares the Lord, and I will bring charges against your children's children. Cross over to the coast of Kittim and look. Send to Kedar and observe closely. See if there's ever been anything like this. And this is the bit you must listen to very carefully. Has a nation ever changed its gods? Yet they're not gods at all. But my people have exchanged their glory for worthless idols. Be appalled at this, O heavens, and shudder with great horror, declares the Lord. My people have committed two sins. They have forsaken me, the spring of living water, and they have dug out their own cisterns, broken cisterns that cannot hold water. Is Israel a servant, a slave by birth? Why then has he become plunder? Well, that was perhaps a long reading, but I want to talk about the people of God Jeremiah is addressing here, who had had experience of him, dramatic experience of him, rich experience of him, and yet they exchanged the glory of God, it says Jeremiah, for worthless idols. Their restless souls had lost personal intimacy with God, and so began to look elsewhere. They still knew God, but only at a distance. It's possible to know God, but only at a distance. These people, in fact, 14 times in the book of Jeremiah, Jeremiah's cry to these people is, "You have forsaken me." God speaking to Jeremiah, "You've forsaken me. You've forsaken me." Are you the people of God? Yes. In New Testament terms, are you a Christian? Yes. Do you turn up in church? Yes. But you don't know me. And as a result, verse 13 says, "My people have committed two sins." Here's number one, they've forsaken me, the spring of living water. And secondly, and have dug their own cisterns, broken cisterns that cannot hold water. It didn't set out that way. They had begun in love with God, as verse 2 says, "Go and proclaim in the hearing of Jerusalem, I remember the devotion of your youth, how as a bride you loved me and followed me through the desert to a land not sown." This is God speaking. I remember when we had this love relationship, when like a bride, nothing could keep you apart from me. You followed me. And I led you into tough situations, into a desert, into a land not sown. And you stuck with me. Why? Because you love me. As the bride of God, and of course in the New Testament, the church is the bride of Christ, is the bride of God. She would never be content with his absence. Other relationships, other activities would never satisfy her in the way that God would satisfy her. Because she was, using the analogy of Jeremiah, married to him. Do you remember when your love for Jesus Christ was deep like that and strong like that? God woos us to himself. He doesn't drive us. He's a lover. He's wooing us to himself. And he often does that by creating a sense of anxiety in our hearts. Something is not right. Something is missing. Something doesn't make sense. And from that anxiety, a sense of being separated from any real significance and purpose and meaning in our lives. And from that, he often creates a hunger in our heart. And if we follow that through, it will draw us to himself as he reveals himself to us. For some of us, of course, our conversions are quite dramatic. Remember, a dramatic moment when we came to know Christ. For others of us, it's a more gradual process where little by little we're drawn and one to himself. You know, when a couple marry, sometimes it's a very dramatic meeting. When I first saw Hillary, before I ever knew her name, I wrote to a friend of mine and said, "I think I've met the girl I'm going to marry." I didn't even know her name at that stage. So it was quite a dramatic thing for me. I then discovered she had a boyfriend, so I had to put him on my prayer list with a big boot next to him. And it took several years before Hillary saw the light. But for me, it was quite dramatic. For her, it was a process, very slow process. And sometimes, you know, you can say it was on a certain date I came to know Christ. It was a dramatic moment. Suddenly, the light went on and I saw and I understood and I responded. Others of us, it's been a process. Little by little, you've been brought to know Christ. I love when God gets hold of people, sometimes unexpectedly, sometimes as a result of this process going on. I'm going to give you one. Several years ago now, there was a Mormon family who were driving on Sunday morning to their church. It was the first snow in November of that year, and they got slowed down and came to the People's Church, and the traffic was thick, and they were moving very slowly. He was actually a Mormon bishop, which means he was the pastor of the congregation that he was going to. He wasn't going to preach that morning, so he wasn't in a hurry. And as he got frustrated, caught in the traffic coming into People's Church, slowed down by the snow, etc., his son in the back seat said, "Why don't we go to this church instead, Dad?" And he said, "Don't be so silly." But he said, and this is his story, "As we got close to the entrance of the People's Church, the car in front of me turned into the parking lot, And I folded in. And my wife said, what are you doing? He said, I don't know. Let's just go here anyway. At the end of the service, I was talking to some people, and he and his wife were in the line. And when I got to them, he said to me, how did you know I was going to be here this morning? I said, I didn't. Have we met? He said, no. But you know all about me. You've talked about me. I said, well, I don't know anything about you, but I know who does. And he and his wife came to Christ. They had two children with them, about 12 and 14. They both became Christians a few weeks later. We baptized the whole family together. I remember asking him before the baptism, how many times you've been baptized now? Because, you know, Mormons are baptized for granny and everybody. And he said, this is the first time I'm baptized in Christ. And he wrote to me, and I have an extract from his letter. He said, I used to teach from the Bible in our church about Christ, but I had never met him, and I didn't know him. Well, the Holy Spirit of God had been wooing him, and in a rather dramatic way, drew him into himself in this way.
You are watching a special edition of Living Truth, recorded on location in Greece and Turkey. Living Truth viewers join Charles and Hilary Price as they traveled in the footsteps of the Apostle Paul and experienced living history. Our journey took us through Turkey and Greece. In Turkey, we visited ancient Ephesus, toured the Bosphorus River, and historic Istanbul. The city of Ephesus was a center of travel and commerce in the ancient world, with major roads leading north, south, and east into Asia. Situated on the Aegean Sea, it was also one of the greatest seaports. Paul visited Ephesus for a brief time during his second missionary journey. Then he returned on his third to spend 2 years there. He faced fierce opposition from the craftsmen, profiting from the worship of Artemis, as he preached against the idolatry and was almost caught up in a riot. It makes for exciting reading. Although in ruins today, you can still see how Ephesus was an impressive city with an amphitheater and luxurious housing for the wealthy Ephesians. Paul taught publicly and from house to house and wrote his first letter to the Corinthians from here, impacting history for generations as the gospel spread. The Bosphorus is a strait forming part of the boundary between Europe and Asia. As part of the only passage between the Black Sea and the Mediterranean, the Bosphorus has always been of great commercial and strategic significance. Most of its shores are heavily populated. The city center of Istanbul is located at its southern end. The waters of the strait are somewhat hazardous for larger ships due to the narrowness and the numerous ferries crossing back and forth. But it also boasts two suspension bridges and a road tunnel still under construction. There are numerous Ottoman palaces and waterfront houses along both the European and the Asian shorelines. Corinth was at the heart of an important trade route in the ancient world and had a reputation for sexual immorality, religious diversity, and corruption, not unlike our large cities today. We see in Paul's letters that the Corinthian church of the time struggled under these influences and encountered serious moral and spiritual issues. In Corinth, Paul met Aquila and Priscilla, Jews recently expelled by Rome by the Emperor Claudius. All three worked as tent makers in the city, and Paul would spend each Sabbath reasoning in the synagogue, trying to persuade Jews and Greeks that Jesus was the Christ. Despite fierce opposition, Christ spoke to him in a vision that there were many in Corinth who were his people, and not to be afraid, to go on speaking and not be silent. Paul stayed 18 months, continuing to teach and seeing many Gentiles come to faith. His sheer determination to keep on teaching and explaining, even when he was rejected, is truly inspiring. Let's return to our message from Charles Price.
Young man called me one day on the telephone, could he come and visit me? And I said, yes, we made a time. He came in to my office. He said, I don't know anything about, what he began to say was, I know there's purpose to life, I don't know what it is. I know it's not in Islam. His background was Iran. He said, I know it's not in Islam. I have looked into all kinds of New Age philosophies, and it's not there. I've tried self-help, and that's like pulling yourself up by your laces. So I decided I'd see if Christianity had anything to say. And I came into the church last Sunday, sat up in the balcony. At the end of the service, when I left, I hadn't understood a single word of what I'd heard. If somebody had asked me, tell me what you heard, I couldn't. I couldn't have put a sentence together. But he said, although I didn't understand anything I heard, I knew it was true. So what is it that was true? And I recognized right away the Holy Spirit, who reveals truth, was at work in his heart. And I thought it was longer, but he told me recently, it was 3 weeks later, he gave his life to Christ. Started a Bible study on the campus at University of Toronto where he was studying. And there was an enthusiasm and a clarity about the way God worked in his heart. And he's now one of our sons-in-law. He was part of a Bible study group that I had of young men. And one Christmas, we brought them all out to our house. And he met our daughter. And so now he's the father of our two grandchildren. But God prepared his heart. He has a story that predates any of this, but didn't recognize the trail God was leading to bring him to himself. And some of you can look back and you know God brought you to himself. You know the Holy Spirit awakened your heart. As God says to Jeremiah, I remember the devotion of your youth, how as a bride you loved me and you followed me through the desert. Nothing was too hard, no desert was too dry. But something went wrong. My people have committed two sins. They have forsaken me, the spring of living water. That is the first thing that had taken place. They had forsaken me. They had known me. They would have had testimony of how I brought them out of Egypt, how I'd taken them through the Red Sea, how I'd given to them the law on Mount Sinai through Moses, how I'd provided with them manna every morning to feed them in the desert. There were many stories they knew of God's provision for them. But you've forsaken me. Can I ask you a question to ask in your own heart? Did you ever know God better than you know him today? Did you once know him better? Did you once love him more than you do today? Did you know him more deeply? In fact, if I may ask this question, did you ever know him at all? Do you know that you knew him? But now there's a distance. This is not pagans forsaking God. This is the people of God forsaking God. Maybe some of us know the truth of the words of a song, a hymn that has this line in it. Where is the blessedness I knew when first I saw the Lord? Where is the soul refreshing view of Jesus in his word? Where is it? It's become dry. And what you do when you lose that freshness, that love of God in your life is the inevitable. You dig out cisterns. That is, you look for alternative sources of the water designed to supply and satisfy your soul. The only problem is they're all broken. Broken cisterns, he says, that can hold no water. What are some of the broken cisterns? What are some of the snares that we might turn to find our fulfillment other than in God himself? Well, I'm going to give you just three. I made a list that was longer. I'm going to give you just three. from different parts of Scripture. I think these three are very common. One is relationships, human relationships. We can look in human relationships for that which only God can give to us. And I'll give you as an example, a woman who Jesus met in the New Testament, the woman of Samaria, to whom he said, if you drink this water that I'm offering, you will never thirst again. So what had she been drinking? Well, we know she'd been married 5 times. We know she was now living with her boyfriend. All the time, in every one of those relationships, she was evidently looking for fulfillment in human love, in human relationship. And every time she'd been left empty. First wedding, full of hope and confidence, this is it. But as it began to not meet the need she knew was deep in her own heart, the marriage fell apart. Second time, third time, fourth time, fifth time. Quit marrying now, it's getting expensive. Instead, just live with your man. And Jesus didn't say to her, do you realize how bad this is? He said, I know exactly what's going on in your heart. You are thirsty. And he said to her, everyone who drinks this water, now the physical water at the well was symptomatic of something deeper, because Jesus went on to talk about not about physical water, but whoever drinks of this water will be thirsty again. You will be. You will be. But whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. The water I give will become a well of water springing up into eternal life. Like a well, it will go deep, and like a spring, it will be fresh every day. The second area I want to suggest to you is something we come across in Matthew chapter 6, and it is a human reputation, that we try to find in our reputation what is lacking in our hearts. So in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus said, be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before men to be seen by them. Then he gives illustrations of those who give to the needy, they announce it with trumpets on the street corners in order to be honored by men. So there's a needy person over here. Oh, there's somebody coming. They blow to them and hope they're all looking. What's that? Oh, yes, you gave. Oh, you are generous. He said, your reputation is totally and only before men. And it will not satisfy you. He gives a similar example about fasting, and you do these things, you disfigure your faces when you fast to be seen by men. You stand up and pray with long, eloquent prayers. But your heart is barren. You know, we can be very interested in our own reputations and think, if I'm well thought of, if I'm liked, if I'm approved, that will meet the need in my heart. It'll stroke your ego and maybe feel good for a while. But it won't meet the need of our hearts. If we're going to allow the Lord Jesus to go deep into every part of our hearts, we have to be wholly disinterested in what people think of us. Because when we are, we're looking over our shoulders all the time to see if people are approving us. We'll look to the left, we'll look to the right, we'll look behind, we'll look ahead and hope people approve us. And that will be a stumbling block to the real work and the deep work that God does in your heart that other people will not see. You'll simply live a superficial life designed to impress.
This is a special edition of Living Truth, recorded on location in Greece and Turkey. Living Truth viewers travel to Greece and Turkey to explore and experience the Living Bible. Paul traveled an incredible distance in his missionary journeys, without the luxuries we experience traveling today. His life was full of hardship, including hunger, imprisonments, beatings, shipwrecks,
and abandonment. He was dealing with the new Gentile believers and the idol worship of the culture, as well as opposition from the Jews. His zeal for spreading the gospel never weakened. As I stand in the same places that we read of in the Bible and literally step into that history, it's not difficult to bring the truth of the accounts to life. The joy of the scriptures is that the Holy Spirit can make God's word alive to us daily, wherever we live, and however different our world may seem. Christ's presence is within us by faith. We can all experience this at any time, leading us in our walk with Him and inspiring us to share our faith.
We now continue our message from Charles Price.
You know, Jesus made Himself, Paul tells us, of no reputation. Which simply means He couldn't care what people thought about Him. He had actually had a bad reputation. If you read the scriptures very carefully, they said He was a drunkard, they said He was a glutton, they said He was a blasphemer, they said He was illegitimate. He didn't defend His mother and say, "How dare you speak like that? I was born of a virgin. Don't you ever suggest there was another man involved." No, He didn't defend anything. Because He wasn't interested in His reputation. And you know, one of the easiest places to fall away from God is when we're involved in Christian ministry, because we turn up in church on Sunday, or we turn up in the Bible study we lead, or we turn up in the Sunday class we teach, and we're a different person to Monday. We're driven by this reputation. And Jesus said the antidote to that is what you are alone. Go into your room, close the door, and pray alone to your Father. Do not let your left hand know what your right hand's doing when you're giving. Fast in secret. There's a positive area of secrecy and a negative area of secrecy. Both come out of this. The positive area is that alone in secret is when you are the real you and I'm the real me. And it's what we are in secret that we are before God. And when we find that what is happening in secret is not healthy, we will start to pretend. And we put on the front. But there's a very negative aspect of secrecy as well. This is being secret with God. The other side is, if we are doing things before men, we are keeping secret the real state of our hearts. And there's enormous dangers with that, because if we have secret sins, secret issues in our hearts that we keep to ourselves, because they are secret, there's no boundary to them. And they will grow. Nobody else knows. I'm not accountable. They will grow, and they will become poisonous. Secrets are toxic in this sense. That's why Ephesians 5:12 says it's shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret. What they do in secret, they wouldn't do in public, but it's poison, and it's dangerous. And Paul said to the Corinthians, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We've got hold of these intentionally, and we've sought to break them. And the third thing is what I'm going to call religiosity, where our Christian living is reduced to form and practice and ritual, but it's all detached from spiritual reality and life. We can learn to behave Christianly. We can train ourselves to behave the right way. And we are caught up in the religiosity of life that is fooling us that this is the reality, that this is actually a true expression of my heart. But it's not. We can participate in the Lord's Supper, for an example, where the Lord Jesus said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And we can drink the wine. "This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." So the communion is the symbols that we participate in, but they're not about the bread. They're not about the wine. It's about me, in remembrance of me. He's the substance. But if we've lost touch with Christ himself, the substance of our Christian lives, we can still go to communion, but you get superstitious about it. You begin to say, either I have to have communion because, you know, this will do me some good, or you become cynical about it and say, this is of no value at all. You know, there was an occasion in 2 Kings when Hezekiah came to the throne. Hezekiah was a good king. And he cleaned up the nation because he followed his father, who had been a bad king. And it tells us what he did. I'm going to read 2 Kings 18, just verse 4. He removed the high places, smashed the sacred stones, and cut down the Asherah poles. And if we were there, we'd say, good for you, Hezekiah. You've smashed these pagan idols. You've smashed these sacred stones, so-called. You've cut down the Asherah poles. Good for you, Hezekiah. But then it says this. He broke into pieces the bronze snake Moses had made. Remember that bronze serpent in the wilderness when they got bitten by snakes and were dying? God told Moses to build, to put a bronze serpent on a pole, and anybody bitten by a snake was to look at that pole. And as they looked at that pole and looked at that bronze serpent, they were healed. Jesus said in John 3, talking to Nicodemus, this is a picture of himself. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. But now Hezekiah comes to the throne, he smashes it to pieces. It's been there for hundreds of years. Why does he smash it into pieces? He broke it into pieces, the bronze serpent Moses had made. For up until that time, the Israelites had been burning incense to it. It was no longer representative of God and what he was doing. It had become in itself some kind of relic. And he smashed it to pieces. And there are things in our lives that are biblically right that need smashing if they become a substitute for God himself. And the most deceptive systems to which we can turn when we forsake the Lord are the religious ones. And try to derive our security simply from those. That's why in Amos, God said to Amos 5:21, "I hate your religious feasts. I cannot stand your assemblies. Even though you bring me burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. Though you bring choice fellowship offerings, I will have no regard for them. Away with the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the music of your harps." In other words, I'm sick of your worship. I'm sick of your meetings. I'm sick and tired of turning up and putting on an act on a Sunday morning and thinking that's what it is. I'm sick of it, says God. It's just a show. Because you see, in forsaking me, you don't just then remain some kind of vacuum. No. In forsaking God, you create an area that will suck into it all kinds of things, whether it's relationships, sexual activity, such as the woman of Samaria, whether it's reputation, doing things before men to be seen by men, or whether it's religiosity, getting hold of all the right practices and thinking keeping these going is going to be sufficient. But says Jeremiah, there are broken cisterns that cannot hold water. How do you know when you're trusting a broken cistern? I'll tell you how you'll know. You'll be drained. Just drained. You can play the act on a Sunday and glad when it's over, you're drained from it. It doesn't feed your soul because only God himself, Christ himself, the Holy Spirit, feeds our souls. The hymn writer said, I tried the broken cisterns, Lord, but the waters failed. Even as I stooped to drink, they fled and mocked me as I wailed. So what do? We come back home. We come back to the Lord Jesus Christ. We allow him back to us. We are the end of the road for him. We let him get to the end of the road, the filling of our hearts, and he is the end of the road for us. If you abide in me and I abide in you, if you look for nothing more than myself, and I'm looking for nothing more than simply yourself, I'm not looking for any performance, and we live in union together, you will bear fruit. And so John, writing to his believing Christian readers, says, keep yourselves from idols, because those idols will pop up in your heart when you perhaps least expect them. Guard the place of the Lord Jesus in your heart. Guard communion with him in his word, in prayer, through books that feed your soul with Christ. Otherwise, you will look for another source of water, but it will be broken, and you will be left drained. Come home. You're weary. Come home to me. Find your rest in me.
You are watching a special edition of Living Truth, recorded on location in Greece and Turkey. Our Living Truth group enjoyed traveling and worshiping together, and meditating on God's Word as a community or in quiet reflection.
Hi, my name's Corrine, and I'm having a great time here.
I'm Kathy, and we're having a good time together. We came because Corrine had wanted a trip, and I had wanted to come where there was some teaching, and so we just decided that this would be a great thing to do. We tried Israel first, and we loved it. And this one we kind of did on the spur of the moment.
If I had one word to describe this trip, I'd say life-changing. How about you, Kat?
That's a hard one. There was a lot of things. I enjoyed all the teaching, but I've enjoyed the great times of laughing.
Yes. That too.
If you're worried about where you're staying and what you're eating and where you're going and the organization, it's all been so fabulous. We haven't had a single glitch. The food is wonderful, and all of the accommodations have been really terrific. All wonderful beds and pillows, and everything has been great.
Well, the food has been fantastic. I thought I didn't like Greek food, but now I love Greek food.
My faith aspect of this trip has been enriched because of the community that you live in. The doing this sort of trip with the teaching and the experience of being where Paul was, of being seeing the streets that Christ walked, those sorts of things in community with people of like mind, it broadens you.
And the teachings of Charles and Hillary just touched so many parts in my heart. It just has been a very moving time.
You might be thinking that there isn't enough new things to learn in an experience like this, but it has broadened us and me.
Me too.
And enriched my life in ways that I thought I didn't know. The experience of times of meditation, times of thinking it through, times of having the teaching and the experience match up together has been really wonderful.
and the quiet time that we've had. So we go off by ourselves for an hour, and Hillary has all these questions that we go through. We really spent a good time with the Lord. He speaks to us during those times. It's been good.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey. Immerse your senses. Ignite your faith. Awaken 2016 Israel is a once-in-a-lifetime exploration of origin and destiny. From November 17th to the 27th, 2016, join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family as we travel to Israel. Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, we'll visit Jerusalem, the Sea of Galilee, the Mount of the Beatitudes, the Dead Sea, as well as other amazing destinations. Ignite your faith through worship and the teaching of Charles and Hillary Price and special guests during a 2-day haven of reflection on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. To reserve your spot now, visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. Awaken Israel 2016. It's your time.
During our trip, we enjoyed a rejuvenating 2-day respite with Charles and Hillary Price, where they shared insightful biblical teaching. We chatted with Charles Price about his message.
Are there some places within the church where you think we've developed some idols? Is that a danger for us? And what does that look like? And how do we keep on message and not let the little things become big things to us?
Any good thing can become an idol if that is going to be the key on which we depend. It's not a mixed metaphor.
Right.
Even doctrine, good biblical doctrine, can become an idol when we cross every T and we dot every I and check everybody else is doing the same thing, but our hearts are empty.
Right.
And our own walk with God is barren.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with doctrine. It's important. There are people who are biblically informed, biblically literate, but their use of what they know is detrimental, because this is the idol. It's the holy book rather than this is the means of knowing God. So whatever does not take us through to God has become a blockage to God.
Yeah.
And therefore, if we define idols in that way, it has become an idol. Mm. And we will fight for it.
Right.
I mean, I've been in churches, my background, where people fought for something. When you stop and think about it, how important is this? And it's not. When you get to heaven, how will this feature? And it won't.
Yeah.
But because it's become our security rather than Christ.
Where do we go as Christians in interacting with our culture and participating in the culture, being a part of it, and yet having the opportunity to bring Christ into it and to speak truth in these areas? Just talk to us a little bit about that.
I'm not sure Paul thought a lot about that. I think he diagnosed the human heart, whatever the environment. He did say, I've become all things to all men, to a Jew I become a Jew, to a Greek I become as a Greek, etc. And I think there's that dimension to communicating your message, which is the only thing that will change that person's life, that you don't want to be offensive to them.
Mm.
You want to be as compatible with them as a vehicle for getting into their hearts. But I think, you know, cultures change, they're here today, gone tomorrow. I travel all over the world and you're passing through different environments, different cultures. But if we understand the human heart, you've got something to say to people. So I think sometimes the church is too preoccupied with trying to be culturally relevant. Mm. I think, I heard somebody say once, if you try to be relevant, you will become old-fashioned very quickly. If you deal with things which are eternal, you'll always be relevant. And I think that's always that. What is the eternal need? What is the created need, no matter what the environment is, that is in every heart? That's what people respond to.
Sure.
People aren't looking for coaching in how to survive their culture. They're looking for what makes me complete.
So how does this work then? I mean, we think about where we live and move and have our being, and just thinking about the interaction of that within a cultural expression. You know, as believers, we are participants in a culture. We're participants in an environment. If we're detached completely from our culture around us, perhaps we lose a little authenticity and a little opportunity to be able to speak into the environments that people are really wrestling with and struggling with. Is there something there? You know, we have to be careful, I imagine, on some level, not to be too detached, to be in the world, not necessarily of the world, but still connected and connecting with people in the real places, as you say. Yeah. How does that work out for us?
A lot of people are tired of their culture. They're looking for authenticity. So I think however that authenticity is expressed, depending on, you know, your own personality and so on, people will respond, I think. To people want genuineness, honesty, love, all the components that the gospel produces, that Christ produces in us. Now, of course, we have to teach the unknown in the light of the known. So Paul talking about the gods and the unknown gods, etc., that's known to them. This is a big inscription, the song you mentioned, the song they knew. So you take what is known, and from it you go to something that is unknown. If you start with the unknown, it's a total fog. Yes, we need to understand where are people at, of course, and where they're at, what are their aspirations, what are they looking for, what really means much to them. And from that, you take them to Christ. It's the end that you're concerned about. Right. How you get there is the use discipline of your own thinking and planning. I mean, Paul is saying to the folks in Athens, your heart is crying for something. These are just masks. It's your heart I'm going to. And I think that's what we have to do.
Do you ever find the environment like a setting such as this, or some of the other, you know, cultural things, and as we look at beauty, and, you know, of course, this is the artist in me coming out and in sort of interpreting some of these things. Yeah. But do you ever find experiences and moments like that where you just feel Christ's presence and a closeness and a conversation, that a dance maybe for
the many ways in which you are very aware of God, and certainly an environment like this or other places can instill that and refresh your soul. I like to walk. Peter and I like to walk together. We walk where we can, out in the woods and away from everybody and every noise and so on. And we enjoy that. But at the same time, you know, I go back to Paul writing from a prison cell to the Philippians saying, rejoice in the Lord. I'll say it again, in case you think I wrote the wrong word down by mistake. I'll say it again, rejoice. I've learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. And I think what we can do is bring God into every circumstance we're in, whether it's a prison cell like Paul, whether it's a mountaintop where you're looking down over a vast panorama of beauty and you just want to sing, then sings my soul, you know, how great thou art. He is present in both. So whereas we enjoy all the additional bonuses that aesthetically we were designed to enjoy and experience, Christ is bigger than either any of those. You can have a superficial Jesus who the sun's shining, the sky's blue, the grass is green, we enjoy life. But the real Jesus is present in the tough situations. Not that we don't have times of darkness as well, we do. We have times of feeling we're walking alone.
Right.
We have to believe by faith we're not. And often when we come out of it, verse 11 Isaiah, I'll give you the treasures of darkness, riches stored in secret places, you may know I'm the Lord your God. So you've been through this dark valley, and then you look back in retrospect, and you see the treasures of darkness, things that came out of it that wouldn't have come into your life apart from it.
And the joy that can emerge from those places and those experiences. But you're right. Without the difficulties, we don't necessarily have the opportunity to experience it and to see Him in all of those places.
Yeah. So much of life is trying to avoid difficulties. Yeah. And we need to go into them with the assurance that Christ is sufficient in them. And I think we're strengthened by that.
Because they are unavoidable.
On our visit to Athens, we met up with our Greek host, Dino Roussos. Dino happily acted as our guide, interpreter, and local pastor.
So Dino, great to talk with you this afternoon. Thanks for just the opportunity to chat with you and get to know you a little bit and hear about some of the amazing things that God is doing in your life and doing through you here in your beautiful homeland of Greece. Tell us a little bit about your background, some of those early days in pastoring.
My father was studying the Word of God, and we are five children, okay. And he taught us the truth, and he taught us that Jesus Christ is the only Savior.
So how old were you when
I was a young man, 15 years old.
Okay.
And I was searching for the truth.
Yeah, beautiful. How does it happen that you move from beyond that, a teenager just coming to faith, to becoming a pastor? What was that route like for you?
Yeah, it was a new congregation, and they needed national gospel preachers, and I know the language and the culture in Greece. So this man, you know, he says, I want to train you how to preach the gospel of Christ.
Wow.
So he asked me when I was 17 years old to give my first sermon. And I was so proud, you know, that I can say a few words to make the people understand that there is hope of eternal life. I was the leader of the youth group,
okay,
of our small church.
Yeah.
And then later, I had the privilege to plant churches in different parts of Greece.
Are there some challenges that you've faced along the way?
Oh, yeah. Especially over here, you know. Here they connect nationality with religion.
Oh.
Okay? And so they say, you know, that you cannot be something different,
right,
than what the people are over here. So once you study the Word of God and you realize there are some truths, you start teaching those truths, sometimes you face resistance, you know, from the people.
So what kind of resistance have you faced?
Well, I remember when I was a young man, 21, 22 years old, I was preaching in the south part of Athens, and it was during the military government.
Okay.
So while we were preaching, we were arrested, and then we had the trial.
You were arrested, and how far did it go?
Yeah, well, they put us to jail that night, you know. Whoa. There were six people that were there, and we had a trial. I lift up my Bible, I said to the judge and the others, I say, I've done nothing wrong, you know, just preach the Word of God. We preach people, you know, we teach people how to become better citizens.
Right.
Better people in their personality and their character. So it's beneficial for the country.
Right.
And for the society we live, you know. But, you know, people have traditions, cultures, customs. And if you are a little bit different of what they are, they don't like it.
Well, they want to preserve that. So what was the judge's response?
Yeah, the judge said, well, you're free. And they find nothing wrong with you.
Right.
And we left. It was about 5 hours drive back to Athens. We were rejoicing. And I want to tell you that it was so important for me as a young man to go through this situation, because then I decided to preach the gospel in a more effective and successful way.
Now listen, you know, just fast forwarding in today a little bit, just tell us about the state of the Greek church today.
The Lord wants us to adjust in different situations.
Hmm.
And when people come to Greece from other countries, either for economic reasons, political reasons, war, they come over here to find rescue,
right,
or to find a better life. And there are millions of them here in Greece.
Yeah.
Like from Ukraine, from Albania, Bulgaria, Russia,
okay,
and even the Middle East. So these people want to know what Christianity is all about.
Right.
And what a golden opportunity for us.
Listen, we've been here with Christian Journeys, who has just led an amazingly beautiful tour for us here in your beautiful country. And I know that you're a partner with them, and we're very, very grateful for Christian Journeys and the opportunity that we've had to just sort of see some of these beautiful lands and to experience the history, as you said. And I'm curious what our presence is like for you and for the people of Greece. And is there any encouragement that we can be to you in just coming here and participating in this way?
Greeks open their homes for you. They are very friendly to foreigners. And when you come to our church, you encourage us.
Oh, that's good.
Because we see that the church is ecumenical, international. God loved the world. And there are so many mature Christians in your country. And we want you to come sometimes again, you know, bring people that they will teach other people the Word of God.
Beautiful.
And the truth.
Well, Dino, listen, thank you for the time just to chat today. You're such an encouragement to me.
Thank you.
And I am going to take you up on your offer to come back to Greece,
yes,
and bring as many people as I can,
please,
so that they can enjoy the beauty that we've enjoyed
and
here.
And give our love and greetings to the Canadians and to the churches in your city, in Toronto and in other cities around the beautiful country of Canada. I love it.
This series was recorded on location in Turkey and Greece and is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this series, write to the address on your screen. To order this series, go to livingtruth.ca for details. Receive the gospel and experience Turkey and Greece as you follow in the footsteps of Paul.
When I think about this visit to Greece and Turkey, I'm reminded of the people who lived here at the time Paul was writing. People would have been going about their daily routine, yet hearing of a man, Paul, who spoke with passion about his God. He was bold, convincing, and filled with love and wisdom. So what did those people do once they heard the truth? Those that believed would have been excited about their new salvation in Christ. Perhaps they went to share the good news with their families, their friends, their colleagues. Maybe at work, at the market, at the amphitheater. There was a new hope in their vocabulary, a new promise in their life. It's no different for us 2,000 years later. We have the truth, and there are plenty to share it with. I'm Jared Earhart. Join us next time for more Living Truth.